whole takeaway of the exercise, biggest takeaway, I would like to focus more on the design aspects, how we approach this whole exercise, how we define the problem, how we scoped it out, and how we ended up executing it, and what are the key takeaways from that. So, yeah, for some of the old timers, you would recognize Curly from the Three Stooges. This is the kind of situation we found ourselves at the startup I was working at. We were just 6 months old, but we were in a very rapid phase of growth, and already some of the ad hoc initial systems we had around events and analytics based on Elasticsearch, already they were not sufficient. We were not scaling up. So if that was the situation just 6 months down the line when we are doing POC, then if we do well, it was a scary scenario. So that was the time when we actually sat down. Very, very broad mandate was given to create some system which can scale over time, at least for the next 2 years. And it was a very broad mandate, no definition of what data is there. So everything was open to discussion, starting from what kind of data we'll need to capture, what kind of capabilities we need to provide, and how we'll end up executing it. And so the company, to give you a brief about the context on who we were. Again, it was a fintech startup, a lot of transactional data, lots of profile information, and it was very in a rapid state of growth. That was the context, and along with it comes a lot of requirements about where exactly can you store the data. The data needs to be localized. You can't really put it in the cloud because you'll have sensitive credit card information. You'll have personally identifiable information. And then there are other concerns around, you're a startup, you don't really know where you will grow. So you need to have a flexible system. You can't invest a lot in a particular technology meant for a particular product because you don't really know where you will evolve. So a lot of design decisions were based on that. Think that we need to be flexible. Over time, if the business model changes, we shouldn't incur a very heavy cost because of upfront capital investment. coming to the problems that we identified, from the very start, we had a lot of people with good and well-justified opinions about what kind of systems should be used to create a generic data lake. But I think we realized that that is a problem we often do. We look at a solution, we get excited, and we execute it. And then we realize that it is not solving the problem because we didn't really define the problems upfront. So the very first step was identifying the problems that we were facing and in the near future that we could face. Again, being a startup, we couldn't over-engineer. We didn't have the luxury of either money or time. So the minimum thing that can get work done for the foreseeable future. The very first problem that companies in growth phase they face is proliferation of data silos. Every new product or feature or team starts storing the data. It expands, and over time, you'll find 20 different systems. Maybe different technologies with their own experts, with their own understanding, data representation, and it's a very difficult task to actually get them together. The problem with data silos is not just duplicate effort and the complexity, but also that now you cannot get higher intelligence by combining all the data together. But people in one team cannot understand the data in the other team because they all are structured in a different fashion. There is no single language that they talk about. So explosion data silos, duplication effort, if you look at production systems, you'll need a different DevOps team specialized for each different system. They could be a edge-based cluster, they could be Cassandra's cluster, and these are real life cases that I'm talking about that we faced. Over time, we had n numbered different systems and experts for every different system, and still you cannot bring all that information together and do really interesting analysis. The last one is an interesting one, data outlives tech. Very often it is said that one of the key differentiators or advantages Google has is the data it has. It has data for several decades. Obviously, the technology that they are using to store that data has changed over time, and that will happen in your organization also. So very often we look at a solution and then we are constrained by how that solution stores data or represents data. But we need to decouple the two things. We need to look at information, how to structure it, and then we need to map it to one of the storage solutions so that in the back end, even if the technology changes, my data representation and the capability should not. So having identified the problems, then we started defining the solution, you know, exactly what technologies, what stack and what architecture should we use to solve it. But before actually jumping into execution, we need to define the problem in an engineering fashion. And when I say engineering fashion, we need to define both the functional specs, like what kind of data you have. Do I have very structured, strictly defined data, or do I have free text schemas which I don't know how they will evolve, or I want to find a middle ground that I'll have free text schema, but it can only be hierarchical, like a tree, a JSON tree. So I need to take that call and define what kind of data representation I want to support. So that those are the functional specification. What kind of data, how much data, what is the complexity of the data, and so on. And second is the performance specification. Those are also the kind of things you need to define before you can choose a solution. Because a solution like Postgre may seem obvious when you have 50 gigs of transaction data, which is the order of data we had in the beginning. But just 1.5 years down the line, we actually had a 7.5 terabyte of Elasticsearch cluster. So you don't really know how things will evolve. So you need to have those discussions and you need to define the performance and all these specs, you know, what is the maximum latency of data that you can live with in your systems. To give you an example, if an event is raised, is it okay if it reaches 100 milliseconds later or 10 seconds later or 1 hour later? Because the cost of a solution between a 10 millisecond or 100 millisecond storage solution and a 1 hour storage solution could be 1000x. So those all are the kind of specifications you need to define. As you implement, and especially in a startup, you can refine those numbers over time, but you need to write them down so that everyone is on the same page. And it really helps to choose a technology. Like when we wrote some of these solutions down, at the very onset, we were able to discount many of the solutions out there because they did not meet one of these criteria. Or we were able to, for example, we used Edgebase for one of the storage systems. So then we had to really, Edgebase is a big table storage format, and it's a key value store. And we used it to store rich, deep JSON objects. So at the onset, we knew that we need to have some transformation layer, you know, to translate this to that. So you will not be caught by surprise later in the end if you write all your performance and function specification at the very onset. So that is one thing we did. We defined the problem, broke it down in this style. Then we defined the data model. Data model is, forget about how it is stored on a file. That is just the storage representation. How you think of data in your head. Is it like a relation schema, key values, or is it like a big table schema or JSON schema? And we also looked at how other people are solving problems. So we had identified that we need something like events, something like entities, like a rich profile, a user profile is an entity. We'll have metrics, we'll have logs. And what are the common behavior all of these have? And can I have a single data representation so that I don't have to create four systems for this? Can I have a single pipeline for all of them and have a single data representation for them? And you know, some annotations or some way in which wherever necessary, I can fork them off into different systems in the edge, not and have a common infra in the middle. So try to reduce duplication. That was the theme. And yeah, in general, not be your vision should never be blocked by the implementation. So that was one thing. We always try to look at the specifications that we have defined and try to create a solution out of that, not based on a particular technology that we have chosen and then based on that we see, you know, what all data we can fit. It should be the other way around. Coming to the implementation, this is a very rough kind of I didn't have enough time to create a proper architectural diagram, but it is a typical pipeline where at the source you have multiple sources for data. It could be a mobile apps. Like, there could be a million users using your mobile app, creating events and doing all those modifications and logs. And you, we had our microservices, several hundred instances of microservices running and creating all these data objects, logs, metrics, events, entities. And then we were able to create a single unified data representation model. And we used Kinesis as our data pipeline. People use Kafka, Kinesis. There are n number of solutions out there. Kinesis worked for us. And we had interesting experience with scaling it, optimizing it. So yeah, we can have that discussion later if you have any performance or scaling aspects that you want to discuss. So we implemented Kinesis that allowed us to decouple the destination from the source. As long as the source has given, handed over data to Kinesis, we know that robustness, durability has been taken care of. Because it is a hosted service, on-demand scaling, we knew that we can scale up to easily 1000x, 10,000x, and we'll only pay for the amount of capacity that we are using. And data syncs, we created our own microservice, distributed microservice architecture, where we could add instances at real time, and they read from Kinesis the relevant data, and they push, fork the data to individual sync. A sync is a data destination. It could be a persistent store, like we had Elasticsearch, we had Edgebase for a while, we had S3 for disaster recovery, cheap storage, and or it could be other consumers, like we had API consumers, which we used to, for example, read data from here. And we did a POC where we were sending data to Amplitude, a third-party system. So yeah, that was the glue here that read from Kinesis and sent to data sync, and we were able to achieve isolation. If one of my technology clusters is down, Elasticsearch, it will not affect any of the other things. So back propagation of failure or data logging, so all those issues were taken care of, isolation between syncs and scaling. So yeah, that was the essentially implementation. Each of these technologies or pieces is complex enough to have a complete talk by itself. So yeah, if there are any specific questions at the end, I can field. Yes. Yes. No, no. So data lake is effectively this, one way of implementing this. Data pipeline is how your data is coming from n number of different sources, technologies, and flowing into this while taking care of scalability, latencies, throughput, all those aspects. So data lake could be, just to give you an example, a data lake could be simple HDFS cluster using, let's say, Parquet file format, where I have dumped all the data. It could be entities, events, logs, metrics in different file hierarchies. And I just need to create a layer of data governance and data isolation so that if someone wants to look at logs, they only look at that hierarchy. You know, and for example, I can put a SQL layer on top of it to query it. So data lake is just a way of storing data and making it enabling people to query it. That is just this part. Yes. Right. So it's a good question. The context is that as a startup, initially we didn't want to create n number of systems, but this gave us enough flexibility to later, for example, if you wanted log data to go elsewhere, there was a different consumer for it which was pushing data to a different destination. It could be the same Elasticsearch cluster, it could be two clusters, or it could be two different destinations altogether. So in terms of plumbing, we had conceptually speaking, four different pipes, one for logs, one for metrics, one for events, one for entities. And we can just change the plumbing here to send data to different destinations. I'll field that question later, just because, okay. Yes. Yeah. So one thing I haven't shown here is this plumbing, basically the data collector, what we called, which read from the persistent queue and pushed into a different whatever the destination is. So think of it that there are different destinations. There is S3, which is for backup and which stores everything. There is Edgebase, which only has events. There is Elasticsearch, which has events and entities. Each of them has this application has different instances running, and it's a distributed application, so you can create 1,000 instances. Each instance knows that I only have to read logs and I have to store it in S3. Another instance knows that I have to read logs and I have to store in Elasticsearch. So you know, there is that glue over here which this diagram does not represent, that takes care of it. And any business logic about filtering, that comes here. We actually had business logic of doing some amount of data health checks and rejecting dirty data. So key wins, some of the biggest takeaways that went well based on the design, and over the next 1.5 years, we validated them in production when we scaled up to, I don't know, 100x the amount of data volume and size. One was that because we had defined the standards clearly, and even though there were different types of data model, there was a simple, for example, JSON format in which we had published that this is how data is stored. So everyone knew, both from the developer who was storing data as well as people who are querying data, what to expect and how to expect the data in, as well as the performance guarantees. We had told that in the worst case, you can expect this much of latency. So even product managers knew that when doing some analysis, they should not complain if they see latencies up to this. So standards was one thing that really helped communicate. Implement to standards, it helped us not create a lot of band-aid fixes, because sometimes you want to do X, but a technology doesn't provide that. So you do a lot of hacks on top of it to make it work. But that happened. Third was less duplication. So we just had a team of 2-3 DevOps which was handling this whole infra, because there was only a common data pipeline in the middle. And yeah, these were the key wins. Some of the things which we did not cover were scaling of metadata. Basically, that was one thing we were going to do next. As your data grows, your data dictionary also grows, and then it is very hard to figure out what data I have in my system. Only then can you actually query that data. So data dictionary was the next logical evolution step that we did not tackle. And data health was one thing which we underestimated. Over time, for example, mobile clients did not have a way of logging, so they started using events for logging information. And then we had debug logs in events. So more data is not necessarily good. If you have data for example, events data, if 90% of the data is noise, effectively no one will use that system. So data health is something that you need to define as part of spec. You know, how do you have, just like unit tests, you need to have all the tests for your data health. And at all times, you should be able to visualize your score and take proper steps to keep your data neat and clean, so that, for example, business results come out right. It should not happen that your city name has small d for Delhi and sometimes capital D for Delhi and sometimes New Delhi. And then someone doing an analysis sees three different categories. So all that data health check really, you know, bite you hard later on. No. So that is something we did not do. That is something we had to build yet. And data governance, we created a distributed async data pipeline. So if there is any unexpected error, it is very hard to propagate it back, or even to realize whether it is a recoverable error or a not non-recoverable error. Because, and do we have time? No. So yeah, that is all from my side. Maybe we can take one or two questions. We had a health report where whenever there was a failure, a notification was sent out to devs, which means me. And we used to have basically classify them and then take a call. And over a period of time, we were able to classify most of those recurring issues in either actual errors or not. But yeah, no advanced system, classification system. Mm-hmm. Yeah, all that was taken care of. That's a basic kinesis, data consumption patterns. Yeah. Yes. I can field any questions offline. Yeah.